So we've never done a talk about a PhD in the Royal Vauxhall Tavern before. So it's a first for everything. Now, it lasts an hour, but you can get drinks at the bar. Just creep over there quietly and ask them quietly. A bar staff, do you mind when you serve them to be a bit quiet? Because it's a lecture. It's kind of like a lecture. It's kind of like a lecture. He spent loads of time doing this, and he thought he might like to share it with all of us. And instead of doing it in the hallowed walls of the Queen Mary University, he thought he'd do it right here. So, as I say, it lasts an hour. And then what we're going to do at the end of the hour is, if you haven't had enough, we're going to ask you, do you want a Q&A or not? You'll probably say not, but we'll ask you anyway. And so, yeah, without further ado, please welcome a very, very brainy bloke. He is a totally brainy bloke. His mum's over there. He's well brainy. He's come all the way from Putney. Please welcome Dr. Duckie.
Hello, everyone. It's like it's literally everyone. This is insane. And excited and nervous, and thank you all for coming. So yeah, like Simon said, this is sort of a long time in the making. It's the RBT. I'd love to know all this off by heart, but I don't, so I'll be trying to perform, but also looking down at my notes a bit, sorry. But yeah, so it's about 5 years ago that I embarked on a PhD based at Queen Mary, University of London, working with Duckie. And it's been an exciting, challenging, and inspirational ride. I've had the privilege of being a fly on the wall at some amazing projects, life-changing projects, and getting to know the people who've made them happen. And in trying to come up with concepts to describe the amazing work that Duckie does in all these different ways, I hatched the idea that, in a way, tonight is all about. And that's the idea of the homemade Mutant Hope Machine, which at the moment means nothing to you, but hopefully by the end of the hour it will mean something, and hopefully I'll convince you why it matters. I'm also feeling incredibly, incredibly privileged today to be standing here on the stage at the Royal Vauxhall Tavern, getting to try to share this doctoral research beyond the academy. It's probably a bit of a fool's errand to try to turn a 100,000-word PhD into an hour-long pub spiel. So, I don't know whose idea that was. And it may well be that for some of you, this might just basically be impenetrable gobbledygook. For some of you, it might be an hour-long statement of the bleeding obvious, so I apologise in advance, but I hope that the main gist will come across, and I hope that there will be some value in it. And my hope really is that the concepts that I developed in relation to Duckie might be transferable, might apply to other projects, and might help other people who are also trying to do amazing things in the world. So really, I suppose my purpose talking today is essentially one of queer civics, of trying to attempt to explore and expand ideas of progressive and radical citizenship. And I've tried to conceptualise some of the aspects of queer world-making as they play out in Duckie's work. And hopefully some of these ideas will be useful to performers, producers and promoters, maybe to community groups and campaigners, but also I hope to anyone who's really motivated at any level by a kind of queer utopian impulse. Because in a nutshell, it comes down to hope. Hope in the possibility that even in our fucked up world, better worlds are possible for people who are victimised or sidelined or, for want of a better word, marginalised. And against the odds, these people, queer people, have the capacity to create and inhabit better worlds. Worlds which might be small and fragile, but are real and do matter. And the more that these worlds are used, the stronger they get. and my term for these worlds and the forms and processes that support them is homemade mutant hope machines. And I'll be talking a lot more about homemade mutant hope machines over the course of the hour. How they emerge. Do you know what? I might hold this. So tell me if you can't hear me. Yes, homemade mutant hope machines, how they emerge from lived experience, how they operate relatively autonomously, how they adapt to changing conditions, and crucially, how they routinely generate hope in the possibility of better worlds for marginalised people. I'll also talk about how these machines can be turbocharged with participatory performance and with queer understandings of family and of fun. But before anything else, I should declare a bit of a personal interest. That when I came out, aged 18, Duckie here at the Royal Vauxhall Tavern was one of the first places that I ever went out. It had only been going for about a year or so, and I loved its weirdness and its booziness and its difference from the shiny, muscly 90s gay scene, which I never really felt at home in. And I've been coming to Duckie on and off ever since. I've also written about Duckie as a journalist, especially since I became Time Out London's cabaret editor in 2009, which was probably the best gig I've ever had in my life. I've mostly been a film journalist up until then, and I've really enjoyed that. But covering this scene was way more fun, and the people were way more interesting, and it also gave me a sense of civic purpose that I hadn't really had before. There was real cultural and political power in this grassroots DIY work that I got to know, a sense of expressing offbeat, outlaw sensibilities in really innovative and distinctive original ways that insisted on making eye contact and in holding out a hand. And I thought that there was value in trying to understand and celebrate and champion that work to a mainstream readership. So, of course, I was gutted then in 2013 when Time Out axed the cabaret section, but I tried to hold on to that sense of civic purpose, particularly in some of the campaigning work that I've done with some of the people who are here today around the queer spaces where a lot of this work takes place, including the work to make the Royal Vauxhall Tavern the country's first queer listed building. And it was also around that time that I saw an advert saying that Catherine Silverstone was in the house tonight and at Queen Mary University of London, and Duckie had got money for somebody to do a PhD about Duckie's work. And that was really exciting, not only because it was funded and I needed work at the time, but also because it was a chance to develop some of these ideas about the value of queer performance and to get embedded with a company whose work I already knew that I loved, which is Duckie. Duckie, as most of you will know, started on a Saturday night here in the Royal Vauxhall Tavern in 1995 as a party for people who like booze and weird performance and kind of offbeat pop and rock like Kate Bush and David Bowie and the Smiths. And it soon found lots of devotees. Saturday nights, of course, still going strong nearly 25 years later. Duckie also then branched out into doing kind of bigger immersive events like Gay Shame and things like the Class Club and Save Vauxhall, often working with big institutions like the Barbican or South Bank Centre. But they also, which some of you may know, may or may not know the scope of it, and I might at this point ask Simon perhaps to kind of give me a hand of a little basic visual aid going on over here. But Duckie have also been branching out. I should say, by the way, that was not a good introduction. Can we have a round of applause for my glamorous assistant, Simon Strang? We'll get to the chalk in a bit. Easy tiger. Duckie have also been branching out into doing some really exciting work based with in communities, doing some really bold and ambitious projects, and the PhD was particularly intended to focus on them. So, super brief little intro to those. The four projects that I ended up focusing on were, number one, the Vintage Events, which is a series of large-scale immersive performance nights that were themed around little-known queer London party scenes of the 20th century. Number two was the Duckie Homosexualist Summer School, or DHSS, which was a summer school for young queer performers hoping to break into the performance scene. Number three, the Posh Club. An afternoon cabaret event for older people, particularly those who might not have a lot of friends and family. And number four was the Slaughterhouse Club, which is a drop-in arts project. A drop-in arts project based in homeless hostels in South London for people living with homelessness and addiction and mental health issues. So, I'm going to go into a lot more detail about these projects later, but first I'm going to thank Simon for his help. And yes, we'll be seeing more of Simon very soon, don't worry. And I'm now just going to go into a bit more detail about the academic frame that I built around these projects to lay out these concepts about homemade mutant hope machines. And then after that, we're going to kind of take a deeper dive into what these hope machines are and how these Duckie projects illustrate how they work in real life. So I basically spent about 2 years kind of immersed in these projects and got to realise that they were all amazing. They were all very distinctive and very unique with their own sort of structures and participants and environments and outcomes. So the sort of challenge was to articulate what was the common motivation for all of these things, what was the common politics, and what unified them, academically speaking, how could I link all of these together in one sort of cohesive theoretical framework, and what concepts could I come up with to describe the power of these very different projects to make, I thought, real differences in marginalised people's lives in very different ways. And perhaps most importantly, what were the civic stakes of this? Was this just ivory tower chin scratching? Or could thinking about these things actually come up with some ideas that might help people really trying to make a difference in people's lived experience? You know, could these actually help people on the margins make better worlds? I think it might be time to bring glamorous Simon back and save again. Because now that we're getting into the sort of academic-y bit, we're going to put some keywords up on the board. But to give it, I'm going to leave that to you. We're going to give it the Duckie Grazzle Dazzle, thanks to Simon Strange. This was a mistake. what did they all have in common? Well, the sort of obvious overall thing was, wait for it, not yet. Spoilers. I'll cue you, don't worry. And it's not going to fit, the word's longer than that anyway. All of these projects were joyous collective undertakings against the grain. They were all fun, hopeful, supportive, group efforts going against mainstream expectations. Not that they were oppositional in themselves, they were just giving people who are usually ignored or belittled ways of doing their own thing on their own terms. So, from a certain academic perspective, that made them queer. So Simon, in the middle of the top line, can we have queer? So, queer is a very slippery term that means a lot of different things to different people. It can be an insult, it can be an identity marker, it can be a position of critical engagement with the normative structures and assumptions that frame our world. The slipperiness of queer is part of the point. It's about fluidity and change and even contradiction. And it suggests a position of difference, of being somehow excluded or misrepresented or victimised or erased, somehow falling outside dominant expectations of a successful and validated life. So in that sense, queer has most often been used in relation to sexuality or to gender identity, but it can also, in lots of usages, expand out into other positions of marginality, perhaps to do with immigration status, or to do with being old and lonely, or to do with living on the street. So in terms of academic queer theory, the particular strand that my concepts are engaging with is to do with hope and utopia and the future. And it's what the late Cuban-American scholar Jose Esteban Munoz called queer futurity. So, can we have a futurity up there, Simon? So, Munoz called queer futurity a critical investment in utopia. It's basically the idea that it's absolutely vital for marginalized people. In Munoz's writing, this is especially for queer people of color, but it's vital for marginalized people to try to overcome the inequity and injustices of the world as it is by engaging in collective hope, by thinking and feeling and acting together towards imagined better worlds. Because while that might seem utopian, it's the only way that they're ever going to come closer into being. So hope is absolutely key for Munoz, but he sort of describes it as something very fleeting and ephemeral that might be found in a friendship or in a piece of art, but that you've got to kind of grab hold of it when you see it. I think, though, that this sort of undervalues the possibility that queer hope doesn't have to be fleeting or ephemeral. It can actually be generated in concrete, routine, intentional, sustainable ways that can fuel ongoing projects of queer futurity in an ongoing way. So queer hope doesn't have to be stumbled upon, it can be reproduced. So this is what I call reproductive queer futurity. It's a queer futurity, collective hope and better worlds for marginalised people, which is routinely reproduced through certain forms and processes, developing and using accessible, reliable and adaptive technologies of utopian aspiration. So this kind of technology is what I call homemade mutant hope machines. So Simon, if on this line here we can have all of those homemade mutant hope machines. And basically, since homemade mutant hope machines are kind of the star of the show tonight and the central concept of the PhD, I'm going to spend a bit of time getting to know them better, and we're going to kind of whiz through some of the basics now and then go into more detail using the Duckie projects that we had a little glance at earlier as illustrations of how these work. And to give Simon some further homework, essentially, what we're saying is that reproductive queer futurity is the theory, and homemade mutant hope machines are the practice. So, Simon will be adding that later. So, what makes a homemade mutant hope machine? How do you even remember the term homemade mutant hope machine? Top tip, sing it in your head to the theme tune from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. It works. So, what actually is this? What are we talking about? What is a homemade mutant hope machine? Well, a machine. A machine is just any form or process that has a routine output, that makes a reliable product. So a hope machine has, as its routine output, hope. So I'm keeping you on your toes here. So now, if we can add under hope machine, routine output. So a hope machine produces hope, but it should also be reproducible in itself, right? So if we're able to make a certain kind of hope machine under certain circumstances, then if those circumstances hold, we should be able to make another one. So they have a routine output, and they are also reproducible. So we've got this thing which is pumping out hope. What could be better? Well, given how contingent and precarious a lot of queer lives are, it's going to be good if this hope machine can adapt to changing circumstances. So it wants to be mutant. In other words, it wants to be able to adapt. And what's better than that? Well, if this is really going to be an effective hive machine, then it wants to actually come out of the lived experience of the queer people that it's helping. Not be something that's imposed from outside with good or bad intentions, but something that emerges from lived experience. So it wants to be emergent. And the other thing, another aspect of homemadeness, is that it's going to be helpful if it basically operates on its own terms rather than outside terms. So it wants to be autonomous. So that's like quite a lot of abstract nouns. What do these things actually look like in the wild? How do we know what an actual homemade mutant hive machine is? What might it be? It could be any of a thousand different things. It could be a straw. If we're watching the Jean Genet film, A Chant d'Amour, where there's two queer prisoners in adjacent cells who know each other are there, but they can't have any contact, but there's a hole in the wall, and they can feed a straw through, and they can communicate by blowing smoke, and then they can have a glorious queer fantasy life. It could be a kid dressing up in their parents' clothes when they're alone in the house, trying out a new kind of identity. It could be a stash of porn. It could be a sex toy. It could be a place. It could be someone like Casa Susana, which was a transvestite holiday resort in upstate New York in the 1950s and 60s, where people could experiment with new ways of being. It could be the Royal Vauxhall Tavern. It could be an organization. It could be something like ACT UP, that provided structures for people to feel their way towards better futures under incredibly trying circumstances. Or it could be something like the ballroom community, addressing all kinds of queer marginal experiences in incredibly powerful and sustainable ways, possibly the greatest homemade mutant hope machine ever known. So, just hopefully, that's kind of sinking in. I want you now just to take a little moment, just have a little think about a homemade mutant hope machine that you might have in your life, or that you might like to have in your life. Something that you know will routinely nourish your hope in the possibility of a better queer life or a better queer world. Something that operates fairly autonomously. Something that adapts to changing circumstances. Just have a little think. Don't worry if nothing occurs right now. Just have a little percolate and we'll come back to that a little bit later on. So, the basic argument, obviously, I say obviously, well, I think at this stage, I think that's time to give a thank you to Simon for now. Thank you, glamorous Simon. It's hopefully no surprise that the basic argument of my PhD is that Duckie make amazing homemade mutant hope machines. So, I'm going to talk a little bit more about these four projects that I mentioned earlier. I just asked Simon to leave. Maybe. I think it's board time again. Yeah. I'm going to tell you a bit about these homemade mutant hope machines that Duckie do. So the first one, the vintage events. So they're this series of large-scale immersive performance club nights that playfully reanimate these real-life queer social scenes, party scenes of the 20th century. The first one was called Gross Indecency, which was set just before partial decriminalisation of gay sex in 1967, set in a kind of secret speakeasy. The next one in 2013 was Duckie Goes to the Gateways, set in the iconic lesbian bar of the same name, which had the Duckie event, had like a super strict butch femme dress code. And then in 2016, there was Lady Malcolm's Servants' Ball, which revisited a bunch of fancy dress balls for domestic servants that were held in the 20s and 30s and became a really scandalous site of queer socialising. And that one had Neil Bartlett hosting a drag seance as Madame Célavie, who had us all kind of hold hands and channel a lesbian, communist, Jewish arsonist from the 1930s called Mimi. That was really special. All right, now, our next project, DHSS, That was the summer school project for about 14 young LGBTQ plus performers, which ran in 2015 and 16. And each year the group, supported by a £300 bursary, would work with a long-term Duckie collaborator over a few weeks to develop a short cabaret term, which were then shown as a showcase here at the RVT and at Chelsea Theatre and at Latitude Festival. And that was led by, 1 year by the amazing Mark Whitelaw and another year by the amazing Ursula Martinez, who I think are both with us tonight, which is pretty amazing. And my sort of abiding memory of that is being in the minibus that took us all up to Latitude each year, just kind of blaring out Christine and the Queens or MIA, just full of all these like young queers going through the square mile at lunchtime, sort of laughing in disdain at all of the identical suits and haircuts of all these people walking the streets, or marauding through the aisles of an out-of-town Tesco in their fierce day looks. Kind of crazy. Our third project is the Posh Club, which is the weekly afternoon cabaret event for older people who might not have a lot of friends and family. And it's a bit like Duckie Saturday Nights in that it's got dancing and music and performance and refreshments. It's just that it's held in a church hall or a community centre on a weekday afternoon, and the average age is about 75. And it's posh in the sense that the guests all dress up like you might for a wedding or a celebration. And there's bespoke decor with like old school elegance. All the volunteers and staff are in this kind of black tie type waiter outfits, and they just spoil the guests rotten table service and compliments. And it's just this beautiful, ridiculous, happy, fun place. And also the only club that we know of where someone has been rushed to hospital because they forgot to take their drugs. Our last project is the Slaughterhouse Club, which is a drop-in arts project for people living with homelessness and addiction. And it's based in Thames Reach Hostels, in a room that's stocked with a whole bunch of art supplies and has experienced Duckie collaborators, Mark Whitelaw again, and also Robin Whitmore, who's with us tonight, and Tim Brunsdon, who I don't know, I hope. But amazing Duckie collaborators working with residents of the hostels on whatever projects they want, which might be drawing or painting or music or photography or blogging or podcasting, all kinds of different things. And when I think of the Slaughterhouse Club, I think of just moments of quiet, of different people sitting making art together, or of a kind of raucous pleasure of a film night where people could see themselves up on screen alongside movie stars, or a funeral event, because a lot of the people that take part in the Slaughterhouse Club die. And there was a funeral event that I was lucky to go to where it was clear that the club had helped to give people some tools to say goodbye to a friend. So, I think, Dickie, if we can bring the screen down, I'm just going to show a very short little video showing each of those four things a little bit in action.
Welcome. Welcome. O seeker after truth and astral wisdom, don't get too smashed, but enjoy the party.
Come on, guys. hates it.
I'm not enjoying myself.
Look at it. I mean, the place is alive. And for one day a week, people are alive and happy. I love the acts, I love the feel, I love the vibe, and it's a good feeling. It makes me feel special. That's what it does. Posh, special.
Even some of the guests have the opportunity of performing on stage for the rest of the audience, which is absolutely wonderful.
Yeah.
Bollocks.
Total
shite.
Hey, yeah, this is Change FM 2. Thanks for joining us for the first podcast, and thanks for joining us for this one. I'm Gary Goodman, your host. We've got some interesting guests lined up to chat with us, and some jokes, entertainment, music. Stay with us. This is Change FM 2.
Participants. I should also. Oh, what are we doing? Thank you.
Glamorous.
I should also clarify, in case anyone's in doubt, that wasn't me in that DHSS video. That's the amazing Dickie Eaton, Duckie producer. Extraordinaire. And it was his birthday that the DHSS team was celebrating there. And yes, Dickie and I are sometimes confused for one another, particularly at the posh club, where I quickly learn it's best just to smile and nod and take the love that inevitably comes Dickie's way. Is a bit more of a sense of these Duckie projects, right? And so I want to kind of tease out how these act as homemade mutant hope machines. So we remember what makes a homemade mutant hope machine. They emerge from lived experience. They operate relatively autonomously. They adapt to changing circumstance. And they routinely generate hope in the possibility of better worlds for marginalized people. And they can be reproduced themselves. So, how do these show them? Well, if we start with the vintage events. So you can see the vintage events, this sort of heady mix of fancy dress and period decor and themed music and bespoke cabaret performance up on stage and among the audience as well. And they're less about kind of recreating these past party scenes in terms of verifiable details than about letting punters feel aspects of the past in the present through our bodies, through our emotions, establishing a precarious but defiant lineage of queer fun. A spirit of belonging, linking past and present, and inspiring the future by promoting the understanding that queer people have always worked hard and smart to make their own pleasurable scenes on their own terms. So they collectively, vintage events, they collectively generated hope in the possibility of better worlds by telling a different kind of story about the queer past, not this familiar story about isolated suffering on the way to normative assimilation, but a story about collective pleasure and self-defined agency and action. And in terms of living, of emerging from lived experience, they basically came out of Duckie producers' interest in the queer past, a sense that this was a really powerful, untapped queer resource. They're reproducible in the sense that they play out over multiple years. We have, you know, and the ones that I'm looking at is these three different events adapting the same format to different settings. So they're also adaptive in that way, and they mutate out of a bunch of earlier Duckie projects investigating the queer past in different ways. So autonomy. this idea of them working autonomously. This is kind of interesting. Autonomy is always qualified, right? No one, nothing is completely autonomous. And most sort of queer DIY homemade mutant hope machines tend to operate in fairly sort of close to the ground, kind of bare bones DIY sort of ways. And Duckie's really interesting in the way that they've managed, they started out like that with Saturday nights, but they've managed to get really adept at working out these different ways of getting funding and support from all sorts of different things, from the Arts Council, from major institutions, from local authorities, from businesses in some cases. So all these different ways to support their projects, these projects, which of course do bring certain kinds of accountability, qualify the autonomy in certain ways. But in my experience, Duckie have really managed to walk this tightrope in a really exemplary way, that they get this funding without it actually compromising what they want to do, or the terms that they want to do it, or the people that they want to work with. So that's the kind of autonomy that I think runs through what they do. So, I'm not going to go through each of the projects in that much detail, but there are kind of interesting aspects of the different ones to pull out. So in terms of the Duckie Homosexualist Summer School, for instance, that was really interesting in the way that it provided this vocational training scheme for students that wasn't really available in quite the same way anywhere else. But it was also like being in a queer gang. It offered a kind of access to a circuit of queer artistic belonging with guidance and exchange. It was about more than vocational careers. Some of the participants told me that it really powerfully validated their experiences and their relationships. And their way of life. It helped their creativity and their employability, but also their confidence, and in some cases their mental health. So it routinely generated hope and the possibility of better worlds, simply by making a future as a queer cabaret term seem more realistic, both as a career and as a way of life. It's also a very interesting sort of case study in terms of adaptation and mutation, that it came out of a couple of earlier summer school projects which were more focused on the creation of a piece of work, and the DHSS format pushed further in terms of developing these vocational understandings about the industry and also about lineages of queer performance to belong to. But then it mutated into something else. After these 2 years, Duckie producers decided it might be more powerful if it was focusing on people marginalised within the queer performance scene, and then it kind of turned into the Cutie Pop Collective, which is a project for young queer, trans, and intersex people of colour wanting to be performers. So this kind of mutation takes place. In terms of the Posh Club, the Posh Club emerged from lived experience in a really interesting way, that it started out as a party for Simon's mum in her front room, because she just moved to Crawley and didn't have a lot of friends, and they thought it would be a nice thing to put on a little tea party and make it a bit posh, and this worked really well, and then expanded out to be a slightly bigger tea party, and then went into a church hall, and now there's posh clubs running in multiple sites around the country, because it's incredibly reproducible as well. And then the Slaughterhouse Club. The Slaughterhouse Club in some ways is a hard one to account for, because it runs to a much slower rhythm than Duckie's other projects, and it doesn't really have fixed goals, and it's not really about performance particularly. But it's incredibly powerful, because the participants of the Slaughterhouse Club tend to be used to either the transactional space of the street or the institutional space of the hostel. And what the Slaughterhouse Club does is it gives them a different space, a space where they're taken seriously as artists, but also where they're taken seriously as human beings. Because often homeless people living with addiction, mental illness, are often, in certain important ways, among the queerest people in our society at the moment. And they're often told, implicitly or sometimes explicitly, that their lives are simply worth less than other people's. So to give a space where their subjectivity and their artistic talents are taken seriously and are nurtured is an incredibly powerful hope machine. So, homemade mutant hope machines. They routinely reproduce hope, and they can be reproduced in themselves. They adapt to changing circumstances, they emerge from lived experience, they operate relatively autonomously, and all of this in the name of reproductive queer futurity, or the rooting generation of collective hope in the possibility of better worlds for marginalised people. So I've kind of gone through a few examples. I've talked obviously about the Duckie project. I also mentioned the straw in the Jean Genet film, and porn and sex toys, and Casa Susanna, and the RBT, and ACT UP, and the ballroom community. So you can maybe see where this is going. You remember I asked you earlier to start a little thinking. So I want now to just take a minute, let's all think about a homemade mutant hope machine that you might have, or you might want to have in your own life, and turn to the person next to you, or make a little group of two or three or four, and have a little chat about that, and then write it down on one of your little cards that we've got there. And then if I ask Dickie to play a little tune, then once you've written it down, drop it off on the stage, or find Simon and me, and then after we've heard a song, we'll talk about a couple of the homemade mutant hope machines. Okay. Amazing array of cards here. Come, come, we're not here to have fun, we're here to learn. So, oh my goodness, well, we have so many amazing things here. Now, I mean, just this last one that I've got is an incredible triptych. We have Amy Grimehouse, who do amazing queer film work, The Glory, fantastic queer venue, and the National Trust. Because we like a balanced diet. Oh, more. They keep on coming. My Diary. Excellent. I like that one very much. We have the Pink Singers. Fantastic group. Someone has my most powerful memory of being told or telling someone, I love you.
Can I read a couple?
Please.
Club Carly. The Cocoa Butter Club. Yeah. Whatever World. Yeah. LGBTQI plus hub at Castle Haven, Cast Haven, Camden.
Amazing.
Luna.
We have a thoroughly utopian one here, which I am all for. Queer passports that allow free movement across national borders. Yeah. We have chemsex. Well, this is going to be subjective. The litmus test there is going to be, does that genuinely operate to routinely generate hope? There's going to be some people. Some people. We have, a WhatsApp support or ramp group. Very interesting. Very interesting. Because that immediately makes me think of lots of powerful support, but also of qualified autonomy, in the sense that WhatsApp is hosted on one of these large corporate digital platforms, right? And we've seen what happens there in terms of when someone like Tumblr or Facebook decides that they don't want queer content, it's suddenly very easy for whole kind of queer cultures to be erased. So interesting to think about qualified autonomy there. We could go through these for ages. I will go through all of these when I'm off stage, but now I'm now I'm like ridiculously behind because we still have the final part of the talk where I'm telling you how to turbocharge your homemade mutant home machines with our three super powerful ways of making our powerful machines even more powerful, because, you know, the stronger a machine gets, the more the closer it gets us to these queer utopias, right? So, yeah, we have wonderful glamorous Simon, who's going to be back on abstract noun duty. Thank you. Because the first... Oh, it's quite hot up there.
Take your
shirts
off.
This show's been mutating. So the first way to turbocharge your homemade mutant hope machine is participatory performance. Which obviously we saw in a whole bunch of these suggestions. So what do I mean by participatory performance? I basically mean any kind of performance where there's a bit more going on for the audience than your sort of sit down and shut up theatre audience. It could be a sing-along, it could be cabaret with back and forth, it could be a more sort of immersive thing where you've got control over what happens. But basically, because participatory performances require audience members to be active collaborators who then witness the consequences of their actions, they're a really good way to cultivate agency. So if we can have agency, as our first word there, Simon. So queer participatory performance events cultivate queer agency, which is not to be underestimated in a world that still basically tells queers that their agency is either feeble or harmful. So we have agency. And a really good example of that from the Duckie Projects is the Vintage event. So in Gross Indecency, there was like a mock police raid where the police sort of seemed to storm in. And obviously people kind of quickly realised that this was part of the show. But just in that moment, it did generate senses of anxiety and defiance, and also generated agency of booing and resisting and things like that. So just modelling in these very small but real ways these kinds of senses of queer agency, queer resistance and revolt. The other thing that participatory performance could do is it can lubricate community. Yes, we're mutating. That they can be really good icebreakers, right? They can help marginalise people to meet each other in the first place, and to share experiences, and to create spaces to celebrate difference. So, in terms of these Duckie projects, the Posh Club is a really nice example of that, where the cabaret format gave people a kind of way of breaking down barriers and just talking, getting to know each other. So, it's not really surprising that we see lots of homemade mutant hope machines are participatory performance projects, either in terms of these Duckie things that we're looking at, or like the ballroom community that I mentioned, which is entirely kind of structured around the participatory performance event of the drag form. So, our next way of turbocharging our homemade mutant hope machine is, well, I'm going to talk about the two of them, because they're ways of harnessing queer fun and queer family. And I'm sort of mentioning these together because they're sort of really interesting to think about together, queer fun, well, fun and family. Because if you trace the words fun and family back, they both used to be associated with kinds of autonomous agency. Fun was actually really disruptive originally. It was very violent and often criminal. And family was, for a long time, predominantly about lineage and also about economic self-sufficiency as a social unit. And then basically, industrialized capitalism comes along. Ooh. And they both get kind of defanged, right? They both become kinds of not work that are understood as being valuable in the way that they keep the capitalist worker content enough to do his job efficiently. It's usually a him. So fun becomes trivialised as this kind of vacuous entertainment, and family becomes sentimentalised as cosy domesticity. But actually some really interesting possibilities open up if we sort of go back to those earlier understandings of fun and family as structures of autonomous agency, and especially in queer contexts. So let's talk about queer fun. Well, what do I mean by fun? What says fun like a definition? I mean stimulating, absorbing, and enjoyable activity that is bounded in space and time and is perceived by those experiencing or observing it as having low stakes. So fun seems not to matter. So why do queers seem to care about fun? Well, obviously, in the first place, fun is really useful as a source of temporary relief and escape from oppressive dominant structures. But I think there's a lot more going on than that. As I mentioned, fun has become trivialised to the point where common sense suggests that if something matters, then it can't be fun. And if something is fun, then it can't matter. But that presumption of triviality opens up some really interesting wiggle room. It means that people having fun give themselves permission to do things that they wouldn't normally do. Thank you. That's really nice. And it also means that people observing fun don't pay too much attention. So, in fact, fun can enable civic experimentation under conditions of reduced scrutiny. And this is really useful for queers, right? Because it lets you develop and rehearse new queer ways of thinking and feeling and relating and acting, and to do it under the radar. So fun, in other words, is like a kind of undercover training ground for utopia. And you yeah. And the kind of genius thing is you don't even know that to feel the benefit. It just happens. Fun is just a really good way to build muscles. Muscles that you can use later in situations where the stakes seem to be higher. So it's important to say that I'm not saying that fun is automatically progressive, because different kinds of fun build different kinds of muscles. So queer fun builds queer muscles, but neoliberal fun builds neoliberal muscles. Something like a shopping spree or reality TV competition game shows. And fascist fun builds fascist muscles. If we think about something like the dark, carnivalesque spectacle of Donald Trump's rallies before and after his election. So fun is really powerful, but it's not necessarily good. That said, I think queer is a really good fit for fun, because queer and fun value a lot of the same things, like experiment and uncertainty and embodiment and fantasy. Now, broadly speaking, the power of queer fun plays out in two particular ways. In the first place, fun can function as a technology. It can be a kind of instrument, a way of intervening in the mainstream world as it already exists to modify or disrupt existing structures, social, political, or cultural. So that could be things like the Gay Liberation Front in the 70s, you know, the kind of protests that they had using lots of costumes and humour, which were a really efficient way of getting certain mainstream people on side and sort of wrong-footing authorities. The police didn't really know how to deal with that. In terms of these Duckie projects that I'm looking at, that sort of instrumental sense, or interventionist sense, let's call it intervention. Simon, would you mind giving us an intervention there? It basically plays out in terms of using fun as an icebreaker, right? At projects like the Posh Club, like the Slaughterhouse Club, it just gives people a way of engaging with people that they wouldn't normally do. So that's intervention, but the other aspect of fun, where it gets really kind of interesting, is that fun can also function in performative ways. That's performative in the sort of academic sense of that having certain kinds of fun actually brings certain things into being. Things like new values, or new relationships, new groups, new ways of acting in the world, that fun can actually create new social, cultural and political structures that wouldn't otherwise exist. So if we can have creation down under there, thank you, Simon. And in terms of these Duckie projects, DHSS was a really good example of that. This trip to Latitude that happened both years was this incredibly powerful site of fun, which created several things. And a few of the students called it life-changing as a weekend. It bonded the group in a new way, that kind of empathetically expanded their understanding of different queer experiences. And it also resulted in the production of some really potent new work that started out as messing about in the woods. Basically, fun was the catalyst for this really powerful sort of queer alchemy that happened, fusing the personal and the social and the cultural and the political. It forged these new friendships, which are enduring and powerful and supportive, but which can't be separated from artistic collaboration or from civic engagement. So that's fun. And that brings us to the last thing that I want to talk about today, the last way to turbocharge our homemade mutant hope machines, which is queer family. So let me explain what I mean by queer family, because obviously that means a lot of different things to different people. And especially if we're talking about academic understandings of queer family, it tends to be used in academic literature in two ways. Either to describe supportive peer groups of friends, who tend to be quite homogenous in terms of age and class and race and sex and gender and that sort of thing. That's one model of queer family. And another model of queer family that gets talked about is same-sex parents raising children in a kind of domestic nuclear family setup. And those are both really powerful structures and provide a lot of love and care, which are really important, and which these Duckie projects do as well. But I want to talk about queer family in a different way, in a way that kind of goes back to those pre-capitalist ideas of family as a kind of structure of lineage and of intergenerational transmission, on the one hand, and also as a structure of economic self-sufficiency and material support. So, in terms of the Duckie, well, there's some really interesting stuff in Duckie projects that I've talked about, but there's a Duckie project that I haven't talked about because it came too late for me to look at in my PhD, which is really relevant here, which is Duckie Family, which was a series of events by and for queer and trans people of colour. And that, obviously, as the name suggests, took family, queer family, really seriously. And there was one event, for instance, called Legacy, which paid a lot of attention to the queer value of intergenerational transmission, talking about ancestors and rituals and archives. The other really important aspect of intergenerational transmission in Duckie's work is the vintage events. Right, that they're talking about all of these past queer scenes, these party scenes, to give not just information, but this sense of belonging, this sense of feeling the past and the present, and understanding it as a living lineage of joyful resistance and world-making that we can tap into and take forward today. Another aspect of intergenerational transmission is to do with not having to reinvent the wheel every time, right? Certain forms and techniques. So for instance, the way that the Posh Club kind of inherits the format of Duckie's Saturday night, and just the logistical know-how that comes with knowing how to put on an event like that is a kind of intergenerational transmission. And also shows how in queer context that isn't a one-way street, right? It can also involve older people benefiting from younger people, that it's kind of fluid and dynamic. And the other thing that I mentioned, material support. Duckie's projects provide all this material support in all these different ways. In terms of the vintage events, there's lots of original archival work that goes on to support those events, which is a kind of family work, a kind of material support. In DHSS, giving students a £300 bursary so that they can take part in the scheme, that's a really important kind of material support. In the Slaughterhouse Club, giving people access to art supplies and teaching know-how, that's material support. And the Posh Club, the fairy cakes that you get there, that's a kind of material support. All of this is really important family work, and it fuels reproductive queer futurity. It turbocharges the homemade mutant hope machines, just like participatory performance and queer fun. So, well, we've looked at the power of reproductive queer futurity, the routine generation of collective hope and better worlds for marginalised people. We've looked at the concept of the homemade mutant hope machine, putting that theory into practice as forms and processes that show us how to make these better worlds. We looked at how to turbocharge those machines with participatory performance and queer fun and queer family. And what's really exciting is that as these Duckie projects that I've talked about, that they kind of illustrate how all of this works in life, as they continue, they get more powerful in themselves, they reach more people, and they adapt more efficiently, and they generate more hope. And they also start to kind of intermingle. So for instance, at the next vintage event, there's going to be some of the guests from the Posh Club who started performing are going to be among the performers at that. So it starts to get this bigger kind of interconnected sense, this kind of growing powerhouse of homemade mutant hope machines. So to conclude, I kind of want to loop back to what I said earlier about the sort of civic aspect of what I've been trying to do, I guess, with this research, and to talk a little bit about neoliberalism, that over the past sort of 40 years, neoliberalism has kind of seemed to be the only game in town, this sort of market ideology that promotes individualism and competition and economic growth, whatever the social or cultural or environmental cost. But recently, we've been experiencing what I think we could call a bit of a neoliberal wobble. Whether it's the Brexit vote, or Donald Trump, or Extinction Rebellion, or Jeremy Corbyn, from all these very different angles, we're seeing a kind of unprecedented amount of mass movements against neoliberal business as usual. And in their very different ways, they're all fueled by the hope that different worlds are possible. So my own small hope is that to those seeking queer new worlds that value empathy and difference and love, the concept of the homemade mutant hope machine, as it's exemplified in Duckie's community projects, might help to bring those better worlds a little closer into reach. Thank you.
It only took him 5 years to work all that out.